decide to drop out before graduating?
Because the system was messing with me. Completely.
It was messing with me too, bro.
Denying me of my rights.
Okay. What have you done since leaving high school?
Music.
Music. Complete music.
Music, bro.
So you're in a band right now?
Yes. We have started our own independent music label company. We have released a 7-inch, and we played dozens of shows, and I've been arrested by the police.
Hello, my name is Cedric.
Hi, I'm Tony.
I'm Paul.
Yes, Omar.
Hi, I'm Jim. We're from a band called At The Drive-In. Being from El Paso has made us everything that we are, really. Not just being from El Paso, but just our backgrounds and what led all of us to El Paso. Like, I was born in El Paso, but Omar's from Bayamon, Puerto Rico, and, you know, Paul and Cedric are from California. Tony's born in Lebanon. So we're kind of all over the world, and I think all of that leads to the music that we make.
We all grew up in El Paso, but we're all from somewhere else except for Jim.
El Paso is about heat and about laziness and about 15 years behind now. All of us came from pretty much different bands, and all of us were kind of the one or two people in those bands that really played like this is the only thing we want to do.
Sometimes my lyrics come from being bottled up in El Paso, you know? You're so frustrated that it's really nothing to do.
What do you want me to tell you? My life story?
Who cares? It's rock and roll. Watch me
waiting. We are back here live in the studios of Channel 65. We're glad to have you tuned in, and we are honored tonight to have in the studio none other than the Drive-In Movie. Only it's not really a movie. This is a local band. How long have you guys been trying to...
76 years.
How long?
76.
You started in 76.
Yes.
They don't remember too much. We don't know what to attribute that to. But anyway, they're a local band, and they're going to play for us tonight. Chestnuts roasting on an open fire. Here they are, the Drive-In from El Paso.
Everything is right,
Okay. Yes. NATO bombs again. headlines in the USA Today. This is the was the drive-in. And who's the leader of the group?
We all are.
No, which one is which was the designated leader? Do we have a Jared, the guitar player?
Jared.
Is that his name, Jared?
Jarrett.
Jarrett. Jarrett, bop on over here and sit down on the Jared, please, over here on the sofa. Thank you very much. And plug that little thing right on there. Put it in there with some of your other piercings. Okay, now how many punk, how many grunge punk rock groups are there in El Paso at the present time that you know of?
A lot.
Probably 15.
15? And where are you usually playing at? Do you play someplace or just kind of in your dad's basement?
The attic.
Alejandro's.
In the attic?
Golden Age.
Oh, in the attic or at the attic?
At the attic.
At the attic.
At the attic.
We make money during this.
You actually make money doing this. Okay. Make money. I can't believe okay, so there's five of you in the band. What's everybody's name? Introduce everybody.
Jarrett.
No, Jared is introducing everybody. Jared.
Jarrett. Crawley. Jim. Bernie. Kenny. Melissa. Carlos.
No, I'm talking about in the band.
Oh, Jarrett.
Just the five guys
Crawley,
in the band. They
Jim,
have last
Bernie
names.
And Kenny.
Now, do they have last names? Are you ashamed of your last name here?
No, my parents are ashamed of me.
Your parents are ashamed. Now,
wouldn't you be ashamed of me?
No, I wouldn't be ashamed of you. I mean,
no, I just don't want to bring my family any shame.
You don't want to bring your family any shame.
Because the only key that we know we're in is when we're in Florida.
Yes.
Yeah. 10 years ago. I guess the media has basically labeled a bunch of kids, you know, as Generation X because. The kids themselves have expressed a feeling of confusion that they're not hippies, they're not yuppies, they're not.
It's confusion, right?
You know, they don't know who they are, where they're at. They have no identity. You feel like that? You feel like that you're in a kind of a twilight zone here? You've grown up between the 80s and the 90s, and
So,
okay, so that's kind of the attitude they say Generation X, like, who cares? I mean, is it kind of like, I don't care, we don't care, who cares, nobody cares?
Well, we're all our own personal little Rod Serlings, but, I mean, still, Proposition 187 could turn into a typical 187 in the neighborhood, you know?
Sometimes when you're out on the road and you need a place to stay, there's usually, like, really kick-ass people. Now, this is not in your metal community, and this is not... in your fucking whatever else community you want. You know where this comes from? This comes from fucking motherfucking P-U-N-K motherfuckers. It's called fucking helping each other out.
This song is called DIY Circuit City. It goes out to everyone out there who knows what DIY is and supports us and supports all the bands, and we just want to say thanks.
Thank you. The way we did it in at the drive-in, we literally gave up everything. I remember it was January 10th, 1997. And I remember saying to myself, okay, today I'm going to drop out. Today, that means I get fired because I work at the lab. And that means I don't have money to live anywhere. So I went and talked to a few of the bandmates and I said, I'm doing everything today. I lose everything today. So you guys got to tell me if this is really going to happen. And they said, we're absolutely in. I went back, dropped out of school, lost my job, and lost my place to live. And we went out, and that first tour that we did together was 4 months straight, and we played to no one every night, and we slept on floors, we slept in kitchens, we slept on the stage that we just played on, and you know, we were lucky to make our biggest payday on that first four-month tour was $50. And we're not the only ones. I mean, so many bands have done this, but it's humbling really fast, and then you know who's going to stick to it and who's going to run home, and none of us ran home.
Yes, this is the campaign slithered in trails in the cargo bay.
You get a release from everyday life, you know.
A new turd is a vastness, hollow vacuum, choppy oxygen tanks.
Everything you have to put up with is just like 30 minutes of pure fun.
from here.
So is everybody having fun so far? Thanks to the first band. All right, Chicago. So this comes out to that gig who's been possibly outside named Billy Jack. I'm really not like that.
Thank you.
Take time out of my busy schedule to talk to you one-on-one about a product that we at Grand Royal are extremely excited about. We have a saying at Grand Royal, guaranteed every time. We have a product that I feel exceeds even our very own demanding expectations. The band, After Driving. The record, Relationship of Command. The sound, well, you be the judge, but I'm very confident you will agree.
Taught us how to channel everything, and we learned how to communicate. Our skills went up, you know, 100%.
He's very spiritual. If he knows exactly when you're not pushing yourself to the last level.
Who's coming right now? What? Who's coming? Baby Pop.
Am I in a talk or a sing? Or?
Yeah, there was something you did like on a really
supercharger.
Yeah, that was awesome.
Okay, cool.
Manuscript
Replica!
You got it!
We got to work with Andy Wallace and sent him some music, and I guess he liked it and he agreed to do it, and so he mixed our record.
Line you're talking about, you blah blah, right. Blah 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 blah. Uh-huh. Does it just start right there, or does it start right at the top of the form?
We're a kind of band that wears our heart on our sleeves, you know, and it's kind of like very vulnerable on stage. And in the future, and on, especially on this record, hopefully you'll be able to hear that.
Dancing on the corpse's ashes.
Hey, give me another ending, just the drums.
So let's go ahead and put this up. Let's go put this station on zero. This station is not operational. Species growing. Bones in an IV loitering.
Yeah.
time we talked about, before this record came out, we had talked about how the new record was going to be very electronic and stuff, and when it came out, it's pretty much very rocky now. There's only like 3 or 4 songs that are kind of really experimental. But I don't know, maybe in the future we'll be doing more remixes, stuff like that. Maybe experimenting with some electronics, but we'll see what happens. I mean, if we talk about it now and say what's definitely going to happen, it won't happen.
Yeah, it'll be opposite.
Yeah, it'll backfire.
Because I once heard someone say that you guys are the Stanley Kubrick of punk rock.
Oh, that's awesome.
That's really cool.
that's what we're going to call ourselves from now on.
Wow, that's pretty.
So how does that sit with you? Or
yeah, I think we always have discussions really awesome. About being cinematic, about being not theatrical, but cinematic, like the big wide open shot of the ocean, you know, like when we write a song, maybe that's what we're picturing. Maybe that's what we see. So we tried to do a little bit of that on this video, and we're going to do a whole lot more of that. A lot more. We talk about, you know, Stanley Kubrick or Fellini when we talk about making videos. And so, I mean, that's a totally nice compliment. But the fact that people have to struggle to figure out where to pin us is a compliment in itself.
Absolutely.
We don't.
I think we've always considered ourselves just a rock and roll band, if anything, because it's pretty vague and
sort of the easiest one to get away with.
Right.
Thank you.
black, an anesthetic penance beneath the hail of contraband.
Dance in the lonely corpses as yet. Find my way near broken bell into the wishing well, wishing well.
Wishing well, wishing well.
Ashes, dancing on the corpse's ashes.
Minneapolis, it was like 3 a.m. and I was walking to this cafe, and these guys, they drive by, and I was kind of scared. They roll down the window, and they roll down the window, and they go, "Your new album sucks, motherfucker," and they drove off.
And I was like, right on, man.
There's been some times where I just feel so, like, happy doing it, you know, and some of the songs sound a little angry for some people, yet that, like you said, will be smiling going, God, this feels so good, you know? So that's why I don't understand why people get this, like, male aggressive thing from us, you know, when they come to our shows. It's like, we're like the complete opposite. It's more just like nervous, dancey type stuff that's going through our bodies, I think.
Our big thing is just, you know, don't hurt each other at a show. Have some respect for each other's personal space. Have respect for yourself in the fact that, you know, just because you're 6 foot tall or whatever you are, please, you know, we're small people, we're small fame people, so we know what it's like to be at the front of a show and get crushed because 500 people are pushing you. And that's what really worries us about playing places that are this size of these kind of clubs. And I think our biggest worry is, you know, we don't want to be the band that this one person got killed at or injured at or whatever it is.
For me, it really bums me out when I see people pushing each other and hurting each other. And like, you can see it, you can see the assholes, you can find them and you can see them look for someone to push, and it's just they're releasing some sort of Neanderthal urge to get adrenaline from hurting somebody else, and that's all they're doing, and it's totally unfair to do to people.
Up, you're really going to keen to see, because you were on earlier, you get to go and party,
yeah,
the rest of the day.
We're going to go watch At the Drive-In, I think you'll find.
Me and Andy both said,
just blew
we
them up.
Got to go and see At the Drive-In. Everyone was talking about them.
Yeah.
And we went, let's go see them. We went and saw them, and it was just like so hot and so packed. It was the best. They were the best band of the day.
At the Drive-In's what we found, yeah. Basically. Unbelievable band to go and see.
I want to go see At the Drive-In.
At the Drive-In.
At the Drive-In?
Yeah. We're actually drinking one-armed scissors at the moment.
You've got a lot to live up to because everyone's like, oh my God, At the Drive-In, they're coming to Big Damn. Oh my God, they're the best band in the world. Oh Jesus, you've got to see it. We just had like guys from Nitocris and Friends of Rom here on the seat going, they were the best band ever, 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 ever. Do you like, before you step on stage, you're like, oh shit, we got to do it again.
No, we just play. I mean, we don't believe that. We just, you know, keep our heads small is a better thing to do, you know?
Ronan, do you dig the festival or do you dig the club action?
I think the clubs are better, but the festivals give you a chance to see all the other stuff.
You know? Any surprises on your set? You got anything worked out? Or are you just going to go out there and rock like pigs?
Just play. It's too hard to get surprise. You know, make any surprises. We're just going to... If we get through the whole set, it'll be like a wonder, so it'll be good.
If we learn our own songs well enough, we might move on to other stuff, but...
Do you really? You don't think you play your stuff well enough live?
No.
Really? Wow.
I mean, it's not our main focus in life is to be the best, you know, tightest. Like, go see NSYNC if you want to see perfect, you know? Like, if you want to see rock and roll, come see a rock and roll band. It's not about perfection. It's about heart and soul.
Just be nice to each other and let's dance rather than beat the shit out of each other. And we do come from Texas and we are called At the Drive-In.
Right a thousand faces. We're only going to walk in.
Hey, thanks for taking care of each other.
But I'm totally wired, can't you see?
This is dedicated to a band from the UK called The Fall. If you don't know who The Fall is, you're listening to too much hip-hop and heavy metal. This is from Mark B. Smith. Stop crowd surfing, please. You're fucking hurting them. Of me all the time. There's Jim, there's Paul, there's Tony. Just because they don't have curly hair doesn't mean they're not important. Media, media, media. Yellow, yellow press.
Like being asleep, you have absolutely no sense of time. Well, if you're driving like being asleep, you have absolutely no sense of time. Well, if you're driving like being asleep, you have absolutely no sense of time. inside were like being asleep.
And this was hidden inside the ventilation shaft, day number 33, Captain's Log 4458. And it seems the captain and his crew are on its last legs. All this culture clash is getting to me now. Am I the last one up above in this space? Tell my wife and kids that I love them very much, I know. Ground control to Major Tom.
everyone on this couch, everyone's going, at the drive-in, at the drive-in, at the drive-in, awesome. What happened when they played?
Well, apparently they played the first 15 minutes of their set, and because they're so intense, the crowd just went nuts, and there was crowd surfing and a whole heap of mushing, and they said to the crowd, look, guys, calm down, no crowd surfing, take care of each other, and the crowd just continued and went nuts, and they went, well, if you're not going to play fair, we're not going to play at all.
One of the, I guess, the most notorious shows in Australia, certainly in Big Day Out history, was, of course, the Sydney one, where you guys walked off mid-stage, and I was at that show, and I remember it very clearly. And I've always wondered what happened when you actually walked off stage. What was the mood in the dressing room? What
some of us snapped at each other, you know? We didn't really understand what the problem was. And with all due respect to a band like Mudvayne, because they tour and they work hard just like any other band does, but you have to be super hyper aware of what that music attracts. So playing side by side by them, and that audience coming over to what we're playing, it just became like Bro Central. And I started seeing people get hurt really bad. You know, and now I have fun and jump in the audience myself. And at that time, I was very idealistic about trying to control that, which is really naive of me, because that's like a huge audience to try to control. So I was getting really upset with the amount of bros that came into our part, which is just really naive and idealistic of me to think at the time, and I just was just really upset by it, and I didn't know how to deal with that size crowd, you know. And I think some of the Big Day Out people were upset with us because we asked for the lights to be turned off, because we like to play just like it's bare bones, because that's how we grew up. And I think we got in an argument with them, and they thought that all the violence that erupted was because we didn't want lights. And then, you know, I was yelling at the audience, and then all these people had come to see us, other bands that were watching on stage, like PJ Harvey people, Queens of Stone Age people. It was the first time we met Queens of Stone Age, and everyone just watching us, and then we kind of imploded. I think it was a good performance, and I think it was really beautiful shambles, you know, because I love watching stuff like that myself, of history of rock bands. Like, did you see when they played that one show? Oh, and, you know, Moon does the dynamite and Pete Townsend's hair, you know, like, I like moments like that, right? So that's what that really is. It's just a crazy, energetic moment that where they placed us on a double stage next to Mudvayne. So that crowd just sort of goes into our crowd and becomes like, and it's crazy. It's really crazy. And, you know, I think I could have handled it better. But, and again, I'm 42 now, and I'm 20-something now, so.
You know, and also, if some of you might remember, Limp Bizkit was headlining that year, and they played later that night, and that's when a 16-year-old passed away, because she got crushed. And for us, it was, I remember when we found that out, and we felt horrible. We didn't know Limp Bizkit, you know, we weren't fans or anything like that. Different worlds, obviously. But we felt really bad for them, because I couldn't imagine being on stage and that happens when you're on stage. And I remember after that, Fred Durst actually did something amazing. He said, I'm never playing a festival again that doesn't divide up the crowd like they do in Japan. Japan's always done that. So people don't get, you know, crushed. And so that was the positive there. But, you know, it was a dark time, because, you know, a 16-year-old got crushed and died at a rock concert.
That, you know, that year where the terrible incident with the girl happened, and Cedric was barring at the crowd because, you know, they wouldn't stop moshing and things like that.
About memories about the festival, you have to understand that this place, Australia, and this festival will always stick out for me as the one of the biggest events in my life, simply because Australia is the only place in the world where we didn't earn what we had. In terms of everywhere else in the world, we went and we toured in a van, and there was nobody at the show, and we slept on the floor, and we slept in some parking lot, and we went back, and then there was two people at the show, and we went back, and we slept on the floor again, and there was 10 people, and we went back until there was 500 people, 1,000 people. When we got to Australia for the first time, which was this festival, people knew who we were, and we had hotel rooms, and we each had our own hotel rooms, the first time we ever had our own hotel rooms, and our records were in record stores, and so for me, it was this amazing, gigantic point where it was like, oh, something really happened here, and then I realized I had to break up the band.
Yeah.
It's going really well. You know, we had started kind of contemplating all of this in 2009. It's been a while, and we've met and kind of rebuilt friendships, and not because there was anything bad, just because when there's a lot of time, you know, spent apart, you have to figure out if you still are the same kind of people. And we luckily were. And then in 2011, in November, we decided, pretty much a week after Sparta did two nights here in El Paso, we all came in and snuck into El Paso. We all came in separately, and we rehearsed at Clap of Thunder, which is Jim's studio. And we just didn't play any old songs, and we just pretty much jammed for hours, like for 5 days a week, and it was there. And we have been offered Coachella for at least 8 years now. And I called my booking agent and said, we're in. And I think he was very surprised. And, you know, now we've booked a moderate amount of world touring, but we'll be all over the world this year.
This program to bring you a special report.
According to a recent report, At The Drive-In are back together and making new music. After reuniting for a string of festival appearances in 2012, the band has begun to share bits of music through emails. But before they hit the recording studio, At The Drive-In will first embark on a short tour from March until late June.
But when you reached that decision and said, right, we're going to do another album, what was like the reason for that? Was it kind of you had fun with the reunion shows, or was it just kind of like getting together and...
It was we were having a good time being in the room playing those old songs, and we knew that, you know, everyone's creative in the band, and we knew everyone just had stuff laying around. So we traveled with a little recording setup and an engineer friend of ours, and we just, you know, sometimes the jam room would have all five of us, and some days no one would show up to the jam room. And we just wrote the whole time.
Who would have thought they're back after 17 years without a record? They're here for the first time in years. Cedric. Great to be back, right?
Yeah.
This band has been in people's consciousness for years. Now it's really back.
Mm-hmm.
And actually, I heard that there is a connection to this festival from years ago, when the band was no longer there. This was the first place that you saw each other again, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
How was that?
It was interesting. It was tense. Things hadn't really mended yet, and relationships were still sort of rocky, but it was the first baby step that everyone took to be cordial and nice to each other and sort of start the process of healing.
What do you remember of that day?
I remember we all sort of met at catering.
Yeah,
and
the inevitable
catering, just sort of like, you know, it's like an ex-boyfriend and an ex-girlfriend.
Yeah.
And it was a little tense, but we were being really nice and cool to each other. And then I remember Omar made it a point to go ride in their bus to the next place.
Oh yeah.
Yeah.
That was actually a move, like,
yeah,
a handshake.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And so and then of course years went down the road, and we were especially I was still saying things that weren't exactly favorable of my past experience, yeah, working with people in the band. And you know, it's unfortunate. I didn't handle myself correctly. But there's only love when there's pain expressed. So that's really at the heart of it, really what it was. And a rock band is a family, especially when you're five kind of kids growing up together. So you've shared a lot. People don't really get that after just watching for an hour or so. It's weird, the ones go back and live with each other. Life is complicated.
We used to go on tour and we would always have like the hometown show before we left, and nobody would ever go. Like, we would play to nobody, 2-3 people, and then we would go on tour and we were playing to more people in other cities than we were in El Paso. But I mean, people will notice when At The Drive-In got big, we stopped. And that was because we couldn't exist in that format. And we tried again in 2012, and same thing. We just, as much as we love each other and we love the band, something about being successful in that band doesn't work. And I don't know why, none of us know why, it's a mystery. I didn't ever want to be famous, or I didn't want my band to be big. When we went to a bigger label, I had an ulcer. Like, every time we would make these decisions to go to the next step, even though it was a natural progression, it was really hard for us to sort of come to terms with it. I was lucky to be around some really good people that cared about me and not about the success that I brought them. I was also surrounded by some people that were very concerned with their income based on my work. And that is troubling, and it does real damage to people, I think. I remember when our video went on MTV2 and became kind of like a thing, played it a lot. And I came home from that tour and people treated me different. This industry pushes you to be self-centered. Selflessness is probably like one of the best things to learn. If you broke down and yelled at the other guys, they're not gonna get your back when you're playing a show and your amp breaks, or you know, somebody's messing with you in the crowd. It has to be this like really tight unit of selfless love. And it's hard to explain, but I'm super sorry.
You know, At The Drive-In's kind of like dynamite. And it's just like, that's just the way we've always worked. And there's a lot of love in that band, but also there's something very explosive about us together in a room. And I think that's what used to come out. I don't know what's going to come out nowadays, but.
What's so fascinating, of course, is that the very youthful energy, the intensity that actually killed the band was also the power of it. Mm-hmm. But can you find that back after so many years? And you've been doing so many things in between, but can you go back to that energy?
Well, it depends on the individual day. There's some days that are on and some days that are off for something that has such high expectations from people. Yeah. Sometimes when they've seen it once and it might have been a great crazy moment for them in their lives, and then you try to recreate that. I mean, we're only human, so we have bad days, but I think for the most part we tap into that energy.
Thank you. How are you living this second life of the band? Do you think it was a good decision to stop and it was a good decision to come back?
That's a good question. Who knows if it was a good decision to stop, but we needed it at that point. We went from the band that nobody liked to the band that everyone loved overnight kind of thing. So it was a lot for us to calculate back then and being young. And to come back 100%, we had a lot of things to finish that we started, and we're getting to do it now, and we got to do, you know, a new full length, a new EP, and we're more productive than we ever have been, so we're really excited to be out here.
Cedric says that that the main idea of your last album was going back to the roots. Do you think it's a mission accomplished?
Oh, for sure. That was the only goal, and I think we accomplished it from the first single of Governed by Contagion. And I think it's one of those things that we knew what we had to do. And our only question was, is this the record right after Relationship of Command, like no time has passed? Or is it the record after Relationship of Command, like 17 years passed? And our answer was, it's the record like no time passed. Like we never stopped making music. And that, I think, Inter Alia solves that.
We'll be right back.
this something that's going to last? Do you see a future for this band?
I do. And now we can apply what people had told us 17 years ago, which was, can't you just do both bands at once? Meaning like one record cycle for one band, one record cycle for our other band. So that's our biggest goal right now. And just to be able to pinpoint when a campaign ends for a record, you know, and for us, because we love doing it, because it takes a lot of work kind of reintroducing ourselves, especially to younger people or people that just don't know At The Drive-In. We have to really embrace that a record campaign can be for like 2, maybe 3 years. So we're in the process of defining that. And then when that is done, we'll do the other band, and then we'll come back, and we'll go back and forth as until we get.
You have years to go.
Yes, we have years to go.
I've never regretted anything, not one, nothing. I think all these things are puzzle pieces, and when you put the puzzle together, that's your life.
Like, if our band was done tomorrow, I'd be stoked. Like, I'd be happy that we did what we did.
Gotta work, gotta work, gotta work.